10, versus a new in the morning. Sometimes I think I went through my allotment yesterday. But I like that. And we'll turn with this in the book of Ephesians. Chapter number 2.
Life by a whole
whole lot. But as far as getting unsaved, I don't think I can do that. Okay. So let's look at this. It says, and you have been quickened who were dead in trespasses and sins. When in time past you walked according to the course of the Lord of this world, I'm in Ephesians 2, 1 and 2. According to the prince of the power of the air, the Spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience, among whom also we all had our conversation in times past, in the lusts of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ. By grace you are saved. Now, I'll just stop right there. So when did grace first appear? Anybody got an answer to that? I mean, you look at your first appearance of grace. And it's not a fair question, because it's really the answer that I'm looking probably isn't in these first two verses. But it does say this, when we were dead in trespasses and sins. Have you ever showed up at a Christmas event or somewhere, and maybe you or someone else shows up and they weren't really on the list, and someone threw embarrassment clothes, and maybe they get a little gift or something, they put a name on there, and you know, and they put it under a tree, or you know, just to make them maybe think that, well, we didn't forget about you. It was a last minute ideal. Maybe you've done that. And sometimes it's just out of kindness, especially for small children and stuff. But you know, the grace that God gave us, you see, was not something that, oh, they need it. I guess I better provide it. The grace that we have, the Bible says Christ stood as a lamb slain from the foundation of the world. In another place it says, whose names were written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Is it before or from the foundation of the world? One or two. But you think about that. God knew our name. God's provision was provided before the fall. That foundation, if you look in the concordance, a lot of times it means from the falling or the casting down. And so before the world ever came into chaos and came into sin, God in his counsel had already said, Jesus will come, give his life on the cross, and be the sacrifice for the sins of this whole world. So sin did not catch God off guard, and it wasn't a surprise. So grace was already there before Adam and Eve had ever partook, before all of the downfall of this human civilization. Grace was already provided. Now that speaks to me about the quality of grace, amen? Because it wasn't an afterthought. It wasn't something that somehow we did to get God's attention. But it speaks to the character of God, doesn't it? He is a graceful, merciful, long-suffering God. And the fact that, you know, we didn't know about it. Maybe you ask this question. What about Lucifer and the angels that fell? The reason I think it was so grievous is there was not a question, as we live by faith, there was not a question as to the goodness of God and God's awesome power. He was in the presence of God, and he chose, in spite of all he knew and experienced, to rebel. And same way with those angels. The Bible says one third of the angels he drew away. They were all in the presence of God, beholding his glory, and yet chose to rebel against that awesome God. And there is no mercy and grace for them. Now, the Bible speaks about those who, in spite of knowing, and I think the scripture speaks about the unpardonable sin. You know, but I mean, if Jesus spoke that word about that unpardonable sin when he talked about those men who, knowing about God and knew what God was doing, tried to credit that to the devil. Now think about that. Those who know and yet somehow try to convince others that it wasn't God. Now that, I think you're getting very dangerous territory. And there's those today who know the truth, but they're trying to perpetuate a lie, maybe for their own ego or some kind of monetary gain. I think hell has a degree of punishment, and they're definitely going to have the worst part of it. Because the Bible says that if you transgress his law and you teach others to do so, then there's a problem. God has a problem. It's one thing to do something neighborly, but it's another thing to know it's wrong. To go on Lucifer and all those angels, they knew. That's why grace didn't come together. There was no question about who God was and what he was. I mean, we're still discovering how many of you today, we're still discovering how good God is. You know, and some of us, you know, maybe have gotten the conception that when we got saved, as long as we did everything right, God was going to love us. And God was going to be good. How many of you know? Have you ever done something wrong and just failed God? And then God still put question. You walk away scratching your head. I know I didn't get this because I deserved it.
Right.
Well, you didn't get any of it because we deserved it. Amen. But I'm not one who can't believe and get what you deserve when it comes to God. But he says, you have the quicken who were dead in trespasses and sins. So when did it come on God's mind to save us? Before the foundation of the world. And how does God see us? Well, we go a little bit further, and it talks about some things that look here. And hath, well, we did. Verse number 4. But God, who is rich in mercy for his great love, for which he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ. By grace are you saved, and hath raised us up together, and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. So now we're talking about not only the possession of grace, but now look at the position of it. God says that he's raised us up. And he's made us sit together in heavenly places. You know, I believe God has a seating arrangement in heaven at the Lamb's Supper. And we have a place at that table. And nobody's going to take your place for that. He's already seen us there. He's already pictured us. Now that's pretty good. Now there's a lot that's going to happen from the day that I got born to the day I die that I'm not going to know about until it happens. Sometimes I don't even figure out why it's happening. A little bit later it happened. But there is nothing between the day that we become born again. The day that we leave this world, it's going to catch God by surprise. And he's going to use all things. The Bible says, you know, all things are good for good. Even the mistakes. Even the times when we seemingly rebel and walk away. God is going to use them to bring us closer to him or to give glory to his name. Now, there's been some that have been, if I can say this, examples. That it does not pay to transgress God's law as a child of God. You know, and they paid the price. And you know what? I firmly believe that they were ever saved. And there's some, I know Brother Steve, they made profession and they loved the Lord, and then something happened and they got bent or they got broken or something, they got hurt. Things went wrong. Sometimes it's medical, sometimes it's physical. And I've seen things happen. I don't write them all. If they were gods, they're still gods. Amen. Now, that's where the world wants to come in and defend. They think we're preaching cheap grace, or we're doing something wrong by inviting people to live that lifestyle. Some of you look at those examples and say, that's how I want to be for God. Because it's a miserable life. And if you'll talk to any of them who seriously are saved and backslid, they'll tell you, this ain't no place to be. This is not what I had planned. That's God's grace is still evident there. Amen. And even, you know, there were some that Paul said, you know, when they sinned, he said, you know what? Such, he said, I turned over to Satan from destruction of the flesh. Why? Because the only. There is a purpose. We can think about that. Even when we shake our fist at God, God's a big one. And so some of our children that go wayward, there's hope for us. Because we can pray for them and know that the God that loves us loves them more than we love them. Amen. And He's going to continue working in their life. And so, I mean, grace has become a big part of my life. I'm telling you, since I've been saved, you know, because I found out there's people, Brother Steve, out there that you can get close to and you can do things with and you can depend on to a point. But things can happen. And all that can be gone. And what are you left with? We need God. You know, and sometimes, if we're not careful, we'll put the people up here. And where we're sitting, we left God down here somewhere. Because we're always running the man. We're always looking for that counsel, always looking for that immediate gratification, whether that is assurance or whatever it is. And we fail. And really depend on God. And God will show you every other tower, every other idol is going to have to come down. So He's exalted and He's alone. And that's the only place. And that's His rightful place. He can tell us God. He tells us that. Amen. But it says, positionally, He's raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ and Jesus, that in the ages to come He might show forth the exceeding riches of His grace and His kindness toward us through Christ Jesus. Now, when we get to heaven, the angels and Jesus Christ Himself is not going to march us around heaven and show us how good whether it's the buildings or the scenery or all the creation. You know what God's going to point to when He wants to show us the exceeding riches of His great creation? You know what He's going to point to? He's going to point to Brother Stephen. He's going to point to this sister here, Sister Heather, Brother Tyler, or Chris, or Joshua. Any of you here this morning. That's the exceeding riches of His grace. That's where His real treasure was invested in. It was in us. Ain't that amazing? I mean, I can just imagine the other verse. I know we don't get to preach properly, but you know what? When we get there, can you imagine just going up and seeing this brother? How'd you get in? Let me tell you. And we got all time in the world, right? So when we get going, people start praising the Lamb. I can imagine other brothers and sisters that get to tell you how I got there. Oh yeah, well this is what He did for me, you know. And it will just be a resounding echo of God's praise, you know. All because that's where God, you know, He made the streets out of gold. But you know what? He put the real treasure in us. That's the great thing, you know. And the angels are going to step back. Because every time they hear it, the Bible talks about them falling on their face and worshiping God. See, that all they've ever known up there is God's goodness, but they've never known His mercy. They've never known forgiveness. They're going to see us. And maybe they beheld, I don't know what all angels see, maybe they beheld some of the races that went on. I know the Bible says the joy in the presence of the angels. They hear the stories. I believe they're going to understand. As much as God loves us, He loves them too. They're His creation. Amen. But He died for us. And in the ages to come. See, I don't think God's through. I know this book is everything that God wanted us to know about Himself and heaven. And there's things that He'll reveal by His Spirit. But this book is complete. Amen. You don't need a Book of Mormon to go with this. You don't need another revelation, you know. These so-called new things, you know, Jesus, don't add to it. Don't take away from it. But in the ages to come, His crowning achievement has been the church. He says, for by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. What did you do to get the gift? Did you deserve it? I believe I got it when I finally realized and just started thanking for it. I went from asking God to save me to saying thank you, Lord, for saving me. I don't remember doing a whole lot to get it. Other than agreeing, seeing it as a piece Esau, seeing me as a sinner in need of salvation, I see in him as the salvation already provided. So I want to ask you, God, and I wonder, you know, there, in that simple step, therein lies the answer to a lot of our prayers. And it's not the height of faith. I know there's people who will claim and says, look at this arm and say, this arm is not broken when it's broken. You know? And that's just not reality. Right. I believe God gives. And I have asked God to heal. And I have asked God to heal. And I thank God for healing. Because he can. It's not saying something really true. It's giving witness to the truth. Amen. Ages to come. For by grace are you saved through faith, that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. Not of works, lest any man should boast. Brother Steve, did you understand a little more about the free will type thing? As far as I understand, they believe of your own free will, you can step away and walk away. Maybe you know a little more about that.
I got a good friend that's pastor of the Fundamental Baptist Church. As a matter of fact, he's one of the preachers of the Bible in Kentucky Park. And how they got the name free will, from what I've been explained to, was not necessarily the salvation part, but it was our free will to come to Christ. Christ never forced us to be saved. That's how they got the name free will. But he said some of them do believe in losing your salvation. They believe if you walk away from the Lord, that then you have to come back and be re-saved. But he himself and his church, he said he's like us. He said, if God saves you, he can keep you. And you know, he said we fail every single day.
Sure.
And a lot of people think that you've got to be out in the bars or doing something on Friday night to be out of the will of God. That's not the case.
No.
You can sit right here on a Sunday morning and amen the preacher and be just as much out of the will of God as anybody else. So there are, you know, some believe that you can lose it for something else. To me, in order to lose your salvation and get back again, Christ would have to come back and die on the cross again.
Mm-hmm.
And that ain't going to happen. So.
No. And maybe someone else has a thought, but that part is always getting to the point where you say you can be lost and you can save again. It just raises one. It's quite a feat to get there, but then to say that you can be saved again after being lost, you know, it'd be one thing if they just believe, well, you know, you become a reprobate and then you're done. You know, and that's problematic. But at the same time, to say that once you get to that point, you can come back and be saved again. And I know Paul at one point said to renew these unto repentance. You know, you can't do it.
Well, there's one scripture in here that says Christ done it once and once for all.
That's it.
And I can't speak for nobody else, but ever since I've been saved, when I get out of God's will and I do something that I know I shouldn't do, the condemnation eats me alive. And if you don't know what sin, you're lost.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I like what Paul said. Paul said, I have to die daily.
Yeah.
You know, there's not a day goes by that we don't have to ask God to help us and forgive us.
Yeah. Well, I'm a big believer in grace. And I'd also believe this. And when you've been saved, there's been a change.
Yeah.
There was a time when, if I could put it this way, I was climbing up that mountain or heading down this way into sin as fast as I could, getting into everything I could. That was my desire. That was my direction. That's what I wanted to do. When God saved me, there was a turning. And there was a change. And I began to climb that mountain heading toward perfection. You know, I'm not going to get there on my own. I understand it. But I want to be more like Christ. That's my desire. But now as I go that way, there's times I'll slip up and I'll fall. And I'll come tell them harm. But it's not my will to end up down there. My will is still up here. You know, that's what I want to do. And I think God changes that one thing. There has to be a change in your want to. And there, I believe there have been a lot of people who have made professions that have really come to a place where they just wanted to unload a load of guilt and condemnation because they were under conviction. And they just wanted to escape that. Not really wanting to live holy or unto the Lord, or even wanting Jesus. They just want to get away from the guilt. And I think sometimes they mistake that conviction and that dealing, that heavy dealing with God, for a conversion experience. Because that change never comes. And they never have that new birth that desires, you know, the pollock has returned to the water in that deal. It's because that's its nature. The nature has never been changed. You can take that pollock, wash it up, put a bow on it, whatever you want. It can look real good. But as soon as it gets a chance, it's going right back where it was. Because that's where it wants to be. Because it's a hog. That change needs to take place. And I think sometimes people have kind of gotten up here, but it didn't get down into their heart. And there are people I realize that have truly gotten saved, but they struggle, you know, with things. And myself, when the Lord saved me, the night I got saved was 2 o'clock in the morning this evening, and I can only speak for myself. I've been drinking, I've been smoking dope, partying, but God sent me vision. I told God, if He'll save, I'll give my life. And I just gave it all to Him. Now, that morning when I got up, I got rid of my all the rules I had. As far as I knew, got all the weed and stuff I had. I even burned all my music. I had, you know, all my rock and country, everything I had that wasn't God, that burned. Went back to work 2 months later, and I did real good those first 2 months, you know, because about 3 or 4 weeks later, we got closed. Chris and I went to church. She came home that night, said God spoke to her, and she knew she needed to be saved, and we went back the next Sunday morning, she got saved. The grave. So all that was wonderful, but when I went back to work, I got around those same old guys. They were all telling their dirty jokes and cussing. First time I got the power on my foot, I heard words coming out of my mouth that I hadn't said in 2 months. And you know what? It convicted me. It's like somebody put a hammer on my chest. And then I started arguing with people. I'd have to go back afterwards to look. I'm sorry. And they look at me like, what the world has not been to you, you know? And I tell people, I literally left work on Friday night with a 12-pack of milk. And I came back 2 months later after being laid off. Because the day I got saved, I quit the ring. And Pepsi laid me off for 2 months. I went from 2 jobs to no jobs. And when I came back, I was carrying a 1611 King James Bible. So they all thought I flipped. But you know, it took me about, when I say took me, I mean just dealing with it. My language is what I had a hard problem with. And my attitude, I mean, it took me 2 months when the Lord finally tapped me on the shoulder. And it was another one of those issues where I set a pallet on my foot or something, but nothing came out. And the Holy Ghost just kind of tapped me on the shoulder and said, you know, it's been 2 months since you said, trust me. I thought, wow. You know, and then I realized God was doing something. But I had went to a preacher there, he was a Pentecostal preacher, and he was actually one that had witnessed to me the Friday night before I got saved. And I told him, I said, you know, I said, I'm having a real battle with my name. Time he was, and he went and got some scriptures, and they were all on the tongue. You know, life and death is in the power of the tongue. You know, a fountain can't bring forth sweet water, bitter water, and every idle word a man makes, you know, they'll give account of the day of judgment. And just all these scriptures that pertain to what we say. And I started studying those scriptures and reading about them, because that's where my problem was with my language. And after 2 months, that language was. And even to this day, if I get in a place and somebody cuts me off and stuff, that'll come up. But somehow God's helped me to keep it from coming out of my mouth. You know, He's still dealing with my thoughts and the heart. But you know, sometimes, you know, those things, why does it be angry and sin now? There's things that'll come up on you in such a hurry. You'll react, but you just, you know, if you pray about it, God will help you. For me. But now, there's some people who have maybe have a harder time And I hate today, and maybe I don't want to offend anybody, but I hate today how people treat, especially, I'm talking about God's people, I'm not talking about the world, how God's people treat other people, say someone that smokes or something. And they talk about mercy and grace and being brotherly, sisterly, and love and all this. And then they'll see someone smoking. And I was just down there at the concert in Virginia. One person light up a cigarette within 20 feet. And I listened to 10 or 15 of these so-called gospel music lovers. I'm thinking they're Christians. And they'll just go off on this person, you know. I know there's health things and everything else, but you know what? Whatever happened about being kind, you know, especially to a weaker brother or someone else or someone, you know, just people that smoke, you know. But it's all politically set, you know. They feel like they've got the world behind them and they're in agreement with that. And they will just come off on people because they're having. There are people today, I believe, that have a weakness maybe for alcohol or for an addiction or for a drug. But they are trying to get their life right. Or there's other people that have just done things. You know? And what happens to the compassion and love and grace? You know? And that hurts me for that brother or sister's sake. You know?
We think sometimes that when we fail and we come short, we're the only ones that have ever done that.
Yeah.
And if you do something you shouldn't do or whatever, and you feel that condemnation, you just feel awful. You know, is that something you should have said or what have you? But then you go back and you look at the Bible on many occasions, you know, Jesus loved Peter very much. And Peter looked right at the Lord, and the Lord called Peter, he said, he's got to go with you all the way to the end. He said, he's denied me three times. He said, I will do such a thing before that cop crew even failed. And think of the love that God has for us still. Knowing the times they failed. Knowing the times that we let it down and everything else. You can't, there's no other, you can't explain that.
No, and I've heard people make statements that, you know, will hurt people. I've heard it in church. And they'll make these blanket statements. Well, if you love God, you wouldn't do this. Or if you love God and you were a child of God, you couldn't do this. And you know what? They're wrong. Because they're people that are false. They're just people. How did Jesus handle it? Look at what he did. Whether he was dealing with a prostitute or he was dealing with a publican. You know, one of my favorite messages, and Josh probably got it on CD or somewhere, is when Jesus came up to, remember Matthew? He was the publican, right? He was the tax collector. And Jesus, and the Bible says, and there stood a man. And I like that because rather than saying there stood a tax collector, but there was a publican, Jesus first saw him as a man. Aren't you glad for that? He don't see us as, well, that cursor or that alcoholic or that drug user. He sees us as an individual.
And that's how we should be.
Amen.
I preached a message here several months back, and I heard a guy talking on a talk show or something. And, you know, we're so judgmental when we look at people doing something, whatever. We say, look at that drunk girl over there, this or that. But if we could look past that, look at the seed in people. You know, when Christ looks at that drunk girl on the street, when he looked at weeds, you know, we were possessed with all them devils, he seen a man in trouble that needed help. Now, if that was me or you, we'd look at him and we'd turn around and run the other way. Maybe not offer him. That's Christ, but that's how we're supposed to be. And it's hard sometimes to be that way. But now that's how we're supposed to be.
But everything he did by the will of the Father. Yeah. And he compelled him to get in that boat that day. You know, when he got there, Lincoln was the only one that came out to meet him. And then when the town showed up, they all begged him, or the Bible says they prayed that he would leave.
Yeah.
And he did. So we have to understand the purpose for him going was for Legion.
Yeah.
And then Legion asked if he could follow him, and then he was denied. So here you have Jesus answering the prayer of the people who didn't want him, but yet denying the request of a newborn, new birth child of God. But it was all for mercy and grace, even for them who didn't want them. He told them, he said, you go back and you show them what God did. How many of us would get mad and say, I ain't never going back there again? The way they treated me, they asked me to leave, I ain't. And I've heard people say that about churches and other things. But look at God's grace and mercy. Even in their denial, he still loves them. And he sent someone back. That's why, and that brings us to the scripture, and we'll close up here in a minute, and maybe someone else has something. But in verse 11 it says, and this is a good thing for all of us to do. It says in verse 11, wherefore remember. See, we forget, like we said, that you being in time past Gentiles in the flesh, who were called uncircumcision by that which is called circumcision in the flesh made by hands, that at that time ye were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. That's a good description, because that's where we were, just like the rest of them out there. But now, in Christ Jesus, ye who were sometimes far off are made nigh by the blood of Christ. And I won't get through the rest of this morning. I can't see what I'm doing about time. But I'm just thinking, if we would remember that it's always been grace, and the right answer to every situation and every person we meet is grace and mercy. Amen. So many people are worried, not so much what God thinks, but what others think. And we need to really concern ourselves with what would Jesus have us do? If we're the only Jesus they're going to see today, they already feel that. Yeah. I mean, when you meet people on the streets, and Dave talks a lot about folks that he meets out there, but I see them out there too, and I have people come up to me at gas stations and different places, and they'll be digging through the cans looking for bottles and things, and you try to give them a little bit of help, you're never going to solve their situation, but if you just show kindness and you're not people, you might sow a seed. We need to remember. I look out there and I remember and I think, that's somebody's little boy or somebody's girl. Or maybe some child's mom and dad, and maybe they're trying to find those bottles to go get milk. You don't know. And I had to go down here the other day and I closed, but I went to this pizza place to do a repair. And they have that rainbow clinic where they pass out the methadone and that parking lot. Coming in and out of there, just the passes, and it all hurt our heart. Because when they take those drugs, they're looking for the same thing you and I come looking for today. They're looking for some hope. Yeah. Looking for some help to get through the day. And but they don't need Jesus. I'm so thankful for Rex today, Brother Steve.
Amen.
I could be in line at one of those clinics today, hoping to get something out of a bottle that will get me through the day. And God's given me so much more. I don't deserve a bit. But as much as I failed him, he could have turned his back on me and never let me feel the Spirit. Right. Never, just plaster all my mistakes across the billboard and everything else. But God, in his grace and mercy, has loved me in spite of it all. And if we ever make good with that, we'll be a little service again. Love you. Thank you for the opportunity.